Welcome to this video mini lecture on male reproduction. In this lecture, we will be exploring the process of spermatogenesis and the structures of the male reproductive tract that allows for the production, storage, and transportation of sperm within the body. My name is Christopher Demas, and I'll be guiding you through this topic. As you might imagine, there are many parallels that can be drawn between male and female reproduction. If you have not already reviewed female reproduction, I would suggest watching these videos in sequence, as I'm sure you will find considerable overlap in content. Just as a diploid oogonium becomes a haploid ovum during the female reproduction process, a diploid spermatogonium becomes a haploid spermatid. Being able to form haploid germ cells is vital to the process of reproduction, so that a sperm and egg can ultimately join to form a novel combination of genetic information that codes for a new organism. I have begun by drawing a schematic of the testicle. Within the testicle is a number of tubes and ducts that are vital in the formation, storage, and transport of sperm. Let's zoom in on a location where the sperm is formed in the seminiferous tubules. This is the location of spermatogenesis, or the process of sperm formation. I will first draw a cross-section of the seminiferous tubules. The process of maturation proceeds from outside to inside the tube. The most exterior cells, or the cells just adjacent to the interstitium, are the spermatogonia, which are diploid cells. These diploid cells can either enter meiosis to form haploid cells, or can undergo mitosis to replenish the diploid cells, so sperm can continue to be generated throughout the lifetime of a male. The diploid spermatogonia become primary spermatocytes, and then secondary spermatocytes. Finally, the haploid spermatid is formed, which can be found at the interior of the tubule. This process of maturation from outside to inside allows for the haploid germ cells to then be transported through the lumen to be stored for use at a later time. Outside of the seminiferous tube and within the interstitium are Leydig cells. These cells respond to the hypothalamic pituitary axis to produce testosterone. It is not a coincidence that Leydig cells are in close association with the seminiferous tubules, as testosterone is vital for sperm maturation. Let's zoom in and take a closer look at this process, and I'll point out the most important points throughout the sperm maturation process that you should make sure you are familiar with. Just as in the female reproduction lecture, the genetic content of the developing haploid germ cell follows the N and C notation, where N stands for the number of chromosome sets, while C stands for the number of chromatids associated with each chromosome within the cell. We will continue to use that notation here. The germ cells begin as spermatogonia, which are diploid cells that can either replenish their numbers by undergoing mitosis, or can undergo meiosis to ultimately form the haploid germ cells. Therefore, the spermatogonia is considered 2N2C, since it's similar to the other diploid cells in the body. The spermatogonia are found towards the outer edge of the seminiferous tubules, as shown here. Let's follow a spermatogonia as it undergoes the series of steps involved in meiosis. The spermatogonium replicates this genetic information and moves towards the interior of the lumen of the seminiferous tubules, forming a primary spermatocyte. Since the chromatids replicate, forming identical sister chromatids during this process, the genetic information of the primary spermatocyte is considered 2N4C. Also, as you might notice, the primary spermatocyte is sandwiched between adjacent Sertoli cells, and are separated from the exterior of the tube by tight junctions. These tight junctions between Sertoli cells help to form the blood-testis barrier. Since gametes form novel haploid genomes, they also can potentially be recognized as foreign by the immune system, and to prevent autodestruction of gametes, the maturing sperm must be completely separated from the rest of the body. During the next step of maturation, the primary spermatocytes become secondary spermatocytes. During the process, the primary spermatocytes undergo meiosis I, and the genetic information is reduced in half. Secondary spermatocytes are therefore considered 1N2C. Finally, the secondary spermatocytes undergo another round of division during meiosis II, forming the haploid spermatid. The spermatid is considered 1N, 1C. The haploid spermatids undergo some final maturation steps to form mature sperm, and then are ready for the next step, storage and transport. The sperm are transported out of the testis proper to the next structure called the epididymis. The epididymis is lined by pseudostratified epithelium with long microvilli known as stereocilia. This is the location where maturation of the spermatid occurs and is a holding place for sperm for later release. During sexual stimulation, the sperm are called upon and travel through the remainder of the tract to the exterior of the body. The next part of the tract along this path includes the vas deferens. As you can see, the vas deferens is a muscular channel lined with pseudostratified columnar epithelium and also contains stereocilia. This tube contains smooth muscle that contracts to propel sperm forward. Next, the vas deferens runs just adjacent to the bladder as shown here. At the distal end of the vas deferens are two paired glands adjacent to the prostate, which I will draw on in a moment, known as seminal vesicles. The seminal vesicles are coiled tubes lined with columnar cells that manufacture and secrete seminal fluid, which is a major component of semen. The progressing sperm then enter the prostate through the ejaculatory duct. Within the prostate, additional secretions are added to the seminal fluid, which makes the semen sugary and alkaline. These secretions protect and provide nutrition to the sperm. Finally, the sperm passes through the penis prior to leaving the body. There are two exocrine glands in the proximal urethra that secrete mucus secretions to help lubricate the urethra, known as the bulbourethral or Cowper's gland. In addition, the penis contains erectile tissue that consists of three longitudinal masses of venous sinusoids, which are essentially cavities for blood to pool. I will go ahead and label these structures in cross-section. The corpus spongiosum surrounds the urethra, and the paired corpus spongiosum is located anteriorly and laterally within the penis. These structures become engorged with blood during an erection. We covered quite a bit of information in this lecture, so let's take a moment to review what we've learned. We first looked at the gross structure of the testicle and looked closely at the structure of the seminiferous tubules, which is the location of sperm formation. Sperm are formed within the tube, and maturation proceeds from the outer edge of the tube towards the lumen. Germ cells start as spermatogonia, which replicates its genes to form primary spermatocytes. The primary spermatocytes divide to form secondary spermatocytes, and finally, those cells divide to form spermatids. We then took a closer look at this process, paying close attention to the genetic nomenclature for each part of the process. The spermatogonia are located at the outer edge of the tube and are a complete diploid cell and are therefore considered to be 2N, 2C. The spermatogonia replicates its genome and becomes primary spermatocytes, which are 2N, 4C. The primary spermatocyte undergoes the first round of meiosis, forming two secondary spermatocytes that are considered 1N, 2C. Finally, the secondary spermatocyte undergoes a second round of meiosis, forming a haploid spermatid, which is considered 1N, 1C. The spermatids undergo a final process of maturation, forming the mature sperm. The sperm are transported through the seminiferous tubules to the epididymis, where the sperm undergo final maturation and are temporarily stored. During ejaculation, the sperm are transported from the epididymis into the vas deferens, through the ejaculatory duct of the prostate, and finally through the penile urethra. During this transit, secretions are added from the seminal vesicles and prostate that comprise the semen, as well as lubricants from the bulbourethral glands that aid in transport outside the body. Lastly, make sure to review the histology of the cross sections highlighted throughout this lecture, such as the pseudostratified columnar epithelium with stereocilia located within the epididymis and vas deferens, as well as the columnar epithelium of the seminal vesicles. Remember how the vas deferens contains a prominent layer of smooth muscle that assists with propelling sperm forward. Finally, make sure you are able to recognize key structures of the penis in cross-section, including the paired corpus cavernosum and the corpus spongiosum surrounding the penile urethra. Thank you so much for joining me in this lecture, and I hope you found it to be helpful.